not going to happen. But I have all this in here, what I've gotten, and I can't get anything from anybody. And I called, first time I talked to Penny today, and she's not sure, because she said this has never happened before, somebody has appealed a decision by the district. So she's working on it, she's supposed to email me, but she's got to call other towns and see how they do it, I guess. So if I could just, I'm going to leave these, so you guys can have them. This is just the stuff that I have. But I'm just telling you that I'm not going away with this. This isn't right to do to us as a taxpayer in this town. I was supposed to come up with a plan to fix my problem. I sent the plan to them. My plan is to do my own sewer system out back. When they fix the front, I'll be more than happy to hook onto this. This is a rental property that I get income off of. And if everybody knows, you know how hard it is to get a home in this town to rent. And if I can't get this done this year, that home, I've been to the people that are in there now, but I want to fix this so that I can get people in there to rent it. That's what I bought it for. Just for that. I can't understand why I can't just get a variance until they figure out what they're going to do out front.
I'm on Facebook.
It just doesn't make any sense to me. Everybody, all my peers, my lawyers, my banker, nobody can believe that this can happen. It doesn't make any sense at all. There's no common sense here. So that's all I got to say. Like I said, I'm not going away. I'll come every time. Something's got to be done. I have to hear something from somebody how to appeal this decision by the CEB. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Jim. My name is Gary Aiken, and I'm here tonight to talk a little bit about the charter. I heard the question Mayor Gaughan asked last week, so I did a little looking myself at some of the things I already knew about. And under the charter, some of these are very minor, some are a little more major. But under the charter, under section 402, personnel system, personnel board, be the personnel board. There shall be a personnel board consisting of city council, all of city council, or three members appointed by the council for terms of 3 years from among the qualified voters of the city. And I don't know if a board has ever been appointed from a citizen of the city. All the time I've been here, it has always been all of council. And I know on your listing of the board members, there's only three council members listed for that board. I don't know why it isn't all of them. Again, it's a minor thing, but it's part of the charter. Section 210, procedure. All council and committee meetings except for personnel and executive sessions shall be open to the public and televised when held in council chambers. However, the council may call an executive session in accordance with the provisions of Maine state law as amended from time to time. This item requires that the specific reason for the executive session be stated, as well as the subsection when a motion goes into executive session is made. Now, this council, as well as many previous councils, have been very lax in fulfilling this requirement. I think even when I was on council, I think there was times that we went into an executive session and the specific reasons were not stated. So, something I guess that you can improve on, and certainly the previous councils could have as well. The next item, section 509, amendment after adoption, supplemental appropriations, that's under A. If during the fiscal year the manager certifies that there are available funds in excess of those so estimated in the budget, these funds shall be used for next year's budget, except in situations outlined in section 509B. The following item was on the council agenda on January 27, 2020. And the item was discussion and possible action item The year-end closeout process for the 2009 budget year is nearly complete. A report from the finance director, Colin Grant, indicates that revenues were $156,521 more than anticipated, and expenses were $202,263 less than anticipated. Regarding the excess revenues, the charter provides the following direction. Any revenue in excess of those estimated in the budget shall be used for next year's budget. I have taken the following excerpt from the minutes of that same meeting. Motion made by Hugh Kirkpatrick, seconded by Doug Morrell, for the city to create a credit reserve account as defined in Title 38 to be called the Rainy Day Fund in the amount of $896,029 with four sources. And amongst those sources is that $156,521 in additional revenues. Discussion followed, centered around following the charter as to whether the 2019 additional revenues of $156,521 should be included in the monies moved to a credit reserve account. Following the city charter under 509, these monies are to be used to offset the 2021 budget. Councilor Morrell spoke about the city's neglected buildings and then expressed his support for the motion. Now, Manager Marker stated that the state provision states that the council would have to determine there was a period of financial emergency to necessitate the use of these funds, but doesn't define a financial emergency. Discussion closed. Six yes, so voted to put that money into the rainy day fund. Even after being advised what the city charter stated by both the city financial director and the city manager, council chose to ignore it and pass the motion to put it into the rainy day fund. This money has always been given back to the taxpayers to help reduce the taxes in the following year. And that's the way it is in the charter, and that's what it says. So I don't know how this come about that this was done, because that's not what the charter says. The last item I've got, section 206, vacancies. Forfeiture of office and filling vacancies. The office of a counselor shall become vacant upon death, resignation, removal from office in any manner authorized by law for forfeiture of office. B, forfeiture of office. A counselor will forfeit office if he or she, under number 6, fails to pay all personal and real property taxes on or before December 31st of the previous year. Under these circumstances, council is required by City Charter Section 206 to follow the guidelines stated. There is a procedure. I'm not going to read it all. I'm sure that some of you are aware of it. Some of you should probably read it. This procedure is required to be fulfilled by the charter. It does not need a motion to be started. It is mandated by the charter. And if council did not begin proceeding, this may be subject to Section 206 of the Charter, Section B, 2, all of you, violates any provision of the Charter. Just a review of the facts. Doug Morrell is a sitting council member. Doug Morrell's taxes were not paid on December 31st, 2019 for the Caribou Annual Report, which just came out here in September. I heard rumors all along, but I didn't know that. Council can begin this procedure per Section 206 of the City Charter at no cost to the taxpayers, and they have control over the outcome. Decision is all up to council when they do it. If they do not follow the charter, they will be subject to a lawsuit. And that isn't a threat, that's a fact. I feel strongly enough about the charter that I think that is the direction I'm going to go in. And I would suggest that you check what the consequences to the city are if you lose that case. I think you should talk to your legal counsel. I know I have checked with mine. Thank you much for your attention. Are you going to have any discussion on this?
I'm not. We'll wait until the end. We'll see what kind of opinion the councilors have in this issue.
Yes, sir.
Are we going to be bringing up the issue of the use permit for Aunt Maggie?
Could you please come up and grab the microphone, yep, sir, and state your name?
Michael David Stigl from Marsville, Maine. First of all, I want to give an apology to everyone on council that was here for the last meeting. I was frustrated because there were some things that had happened on the back end of the use permit that you folks are not aware of that could have potential liabilities to the town of Caribou, and I want you to know that. And I want to apologize because, you know, some of you folks did not even get the chance to get to know who I am, and I've learned since the last meeting who some of you are. I've learned a lot about the people in this room, which helps me, because I do know that the people that are here are passionate about the town, care about the town, and if we have concerns about Aunt Maggie's medical marijuana and bakery and someone getting a use permit, we went through all the stages back in August when we were promised that use permit and said, you know, that the planning board had voted yes on that use permit, and then there was an intervention by someone that works for the town. I will not mention that person because I don't want to do that publicly because I respect that person, but even though they went and backdoored us and stopped the proceedings of the use permit, and then there was some haggling with the landlord of that property, and we're in a situation right now that we don't even know if we have a place to rent, and we've given our money, which, again, I'm sharing this with you because the town of our city of Caribou may be liable, because I'm not a fool. If someone restricts me from, you know, my constitutional right to make money and earn a living, and they do it underhandedly and I can prove it, there's consequences. Don't be fooled. I'm a whole man, I'm not a half man. We run a very good business in Mars Hill. We were just recognized for the best burger, Timberwolves Barbecue. And we've struggled in the beginning. We struggled very hard. And I'm not perfect, no one in this room is perfect. I suffered from a brain injury back in 2011, I overcame that. And then I built Timberwolves and I overcame, some racism in the town and things that people have done, and I've embraced the town with love, and I'm going to continue to do that, and I'm going to do that here in front of you. I'm going to show humility, but I caution the town that if someone has a problem with anything that's going on in the town, you can't use strong arm backdoor techniques to stop someone. I think getting people together and having a conversation about the rules and the regulations and informing someone like me that's affected in a positive way and open the door for effective communication so we all can be on the same page is the way to do it. If the town made a mistake and issued a use permit without having the full power and knowledge of what they did, you know, that should be brought to everyone's attention. We don't hide those things. And then if the chief of police has concerns about medical marijuana coming to the town, it's already here. I wish that I was brought in on that conversation, not treated like I didn't count there, or that I wasn't smart enough to adequately may or may not have done. I care about this community. We're not trying to do anything to harm the community or to hurt anyone here. Anything that we want to do potentially with medical marijuana, the state of Maine, you know, regulates that just like they regulate my liquor.
Sir, could I ask you to speak in
my... Just like they regulate my liquor license. You know, all of those things are regulated. There's laws in place to make sure that you're selling things to people with ID, with a medical marijuana card, that you're not, you know, hurting anyone. So, again, I just want to say thank you to everyone here, including the chief. I just wish in the future that you include me, or, you know, and Chandler, and on what you're doing, because I know my rights. I could, you know, I could take this to a totally different arena, but I'm not there, because I care about Aroostook County, I care about Caribou, and I care about the people that are here just trying to make things work. So, with all due respect, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else wish to speak to me?
Good evening, counselors and staff. My name is Christine Lister, and I live in Caribou. And I am here with regards to the agenda and City Manager Marker's findings and recommendations regarding the violation of Charter Section 2.01B. I will say, disclosure, I timed myself, I'm a little over 5 minutes, but it is prepared, so I'm not going to ramble. For those watching, I'd like to give a little history of this provision. In 2008, this line read as the following. Eligibility. Only qualified voters of the city shall be eligible to hold the office of councilor. In June 2009, five men, Philip Trombley, Philip McDonough, Paul Terrio, Donald Gaughan, and City Councilor Doug Morrell formed a petitioner's committee to change the Caribou Charter, most specifically in section 5.06 regarding the budget. The City Council at the time had the option to support the proposed amendment or vote to deny the request of the committee, which would have forced the petitioners to gather the required amount of signatures to put the issue on the ballot. They chose to deny the request of the committee. The petition did prevail, however, and a year later, on June 8, 2010, a special election was held. The majority of electors of Caribou voted to start the legal process that would establish a charter commission, provided for consideration of revisions to the existing charter, allowed for the drafting of a new municipal charter, and for the reexamination of the current form of governance. The next step was to elect charter commission members. These people were not appointed. They did not simply volunteer to show up. They had to be found worthy of their fellow community members to take on the job of amending the document by which our entire city government is run. From June until November, many citizens of Caribou wrote letters to the editor, pleading with voters to pay attention, elect good people, and understand just how significant this commission and the people would be going through was. Even our current councilors, Terrio and Morrell, offered their thoughts at that time. From a letter to the editor published on March 9th of 2010, Councilor Morrell wrote, "We all know the old saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But there are little tweaks that can be made within the charter that we feel can vastly improve the way the city is governed and will give more control to the people. And there are also some areas that simply need to be spelled out, word for word, to establish proper procedure. Charter revisions would simply close up loopholes and spell out sections that are right now too vague. When something is written clearly in black and white, there is no question as to how an issue is to be handled. It will be cast in stone," end quote. On November 2nd of 2010, 9 Caribou citizens were elected to serve on this commission. On November 18th, an organizational meeting was held with the commission to review the charter. Out of that meeting, no less than 11 amendments were proposed to the charter. Over the course of the next year, the commission held public hearings and submitted a preliminary and final report under the supervision of the city attorney, who determined that the changes were so substantial that the document would have to be a new charter. On November 8th, 2011, the voters of Caribou elected to enter the new year with a new charter. Job well done. So then, why are we here? Why is there a question about this provision? We are here because there has been a precedent set. It was set first in February of 2013, in fact, by then City Manager Bleese. On February 11th, there was a discussion in the City Council as to how to properly fill a vacancy on the Council. City Manager Bleese was directed to speak with the former Charter Commission members as to the intent of the section that addressed Council vacancies, which he did in time for their next meeting on February 25th. This is very important. the Charter Commission members were consulted about their intent. In September 2013, members of the public and some city councilors felt that the section 2.01b and 2.06b6 should be stricken from the charter. Unlike when the petitioners committee requested it in 2009, the council now voted to include the amendment on the November ballot, where the majority of the electors had the opportunity to vote on this as a single issue. What is also significant about this timeline is that November's ballot included four council seats. Two of them were under a special election ballot, meaning they would need to be sworn in at the very next council meeting in November, not January. Two people were duly elected to fill these terms, only one of them was seated. Why? Because the city government deemed the other councilor-elect ineligible by section 2.066, which had just been voted on that very day and passed to be kept in the charter. Now we find ourselves in another situation with section 2.01b and 2.06. Despite the precedent set in 2011 and in 2013, where the council was excused via 2.06b6 with the support of the city government, in January of this year, 2020, was that precedent ignored, overlooked, forgotten? It certainly wasn't held to be the standard by which our city council has, for the last 7 to 9 years, held as the defining course of action in these matters. Now, could I excuse ignorance? Maybe. Our city government today is not composed of the exact same players as was back then. However, after spending several days reviewing over 6 years of meeting minutes and reading newspaper articles and letters to the editor, I can assure you that there are at least four people in this room right now that know intimately that what was happening on January 2nd, 2020, they knew it and are 100% complicit on why I am standing here before you today. I respectfully disagree with Manager Marker's conclusion that the Maine Municipal Association has the final word on how to interpret the charter. In a letter dated January 8th of 2020, legal counsel writes, quote, the provisions of section 2.06 regarding forfeiture of office for non-payment of taxes are clear. If a counselor fails to pay his or her taxes by December 31st of any year, that counselor shall have forfeited his or her office, end quote. He goes on to write that, quote, the provisions regarding eligibility in section 2.01 are less clear and subject to several interpretations, end quote. My question is, why has the council advice changed? Why not when the charter was being drafted and was found to be constitutional and without conflict? Why not when in November 2013, not only was the question passed at the ballot and then applied to an elected councilor the very next day? No interpretation was needed then. Finally, knowing that legal counsel has faithfully and loyally executed his duties, I find the following statement to be inconsistent again with precedent. Counsel writes, quote, the presumed goal of the Charter Commission of ensuring that a sitting councilor's taxes are paid by December 31st of the prior year before taking office is fully met with the interpretation adopted by MMA and myself, end quote. With having the most respect for city legal counsel, I will not presume to know the goal of the Charter Commission. And just as City Manager Bleas reached out to the Commission in 2013 to understand their intent, I reached out to the members of the Charter Commission. I have here with me statements from John Swanberg, Jim Savage, Sandra Huck, Roy Alden, David Martin, Ron Willey, and Patricia Collins. We asked them. They do not all agree that their goal was the same as the interpretation of the Maine Municipal Association. Instead of the document that they drafted and has led our city for the last almost 10 years. As Ms. Patricia Collins put it, it was the intent of the Charter Commission to have the council pay their taxes no later than December 31st. The date was not put there arbitrarily. It was a deadline for eligibility. The city of Caribou has done this before with very different results. When another duly elected community member failed to pay their taxes before December 31st of the previous year, that councilor-elect was not permitted to take the seat as per the charter, as per the goal of the commission. We should not be here. I should not be here. This issue should have been resolved on January 2nd at 9 a.m. when the doors opened and it was confirmed that taxes had not been paid. Not 5 minutes before swearing in began, which also blatantly pushes the boundaries of even section 2.01b and requiring even more services of our city's legal counsel. The city councils, the councilors, and city manager now have a duty to correct this matter. Also provided in the charter from 2011 are steps that must be taken to restore the integrity of the process which our city has spent 9 long years abiding by. It is not for the Maine Municipal Association to reinterpret what the commission wrote what the voters voted on, what the previous councils have adhered to. Our local government is not so big that we cannot maintain honesty and accountability. If you want to change the provision, do it the right way. Don't force us to crawl through years of history to straighten out the present. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, council members and staff.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak tonight? There is none. I'll close agenda item number 4, the public forum. Anybody have any
Charger.
Bacon? Gary, anyone have any questions for Gary on his comments or anything from the council?
I do for both Gary and Christine. Gary, you come in and make comments about hiring an attorney, which is your prerogative. You know where to take your, send your attorney to. Legal counsel's already given that read on this. If you guys are unhappy with that, I'm sorry, but that's the luck of the draw. That's what the attorney has told us.
I'm quite aware of what the attorney said.
I'm not going to debate you on it. I'm just telling you that, you know, you want to talk about attorneys and hiring them, then do what you got to do.
No, I was just going to say what the attorney said in his.
We'll see the city attorney and straighten it out.
Okay.
Thank you.
On this subject, we all went into executive session and I followed what the city attorney said to do. That's all I can't really, I don't know how far I go into what we were told and all that, but I just followed what the attorney said.
Gentlemen, I suggest you read the charter. I mean, section 206 is very straightforward. You have
anybody?
A city council member who did not pay their taxes by December 31st of the previous year. There is a procedure to go through. That's all I'm asking you to do.
No, I'm asking you to speak to the microphone. We just got asked. Everyone speak to the microphone from a lady in the public. Now,
I don't have anything against Doug, and I don't think he's got anything against me. I'm here because I believe in this charter. There is a way in this charter to do this. There is a procedure there. You go through the procedure, and then if you determine that you don't think it's a forfeiture of office, that's your decision. But follow the charter and go through the procedure.
We did, Gary. We asked.
You did go through the procedure for forfeiture of office. I mean, that's all I'm asking you to do. You know, it's very straightforward. It's there. You have a counselor, city councilor, who did not pay his taxes by December 31st. So go through this procedure and come up with whatever you...
Take it back. He wasn't a city councilor.
Doesn't matter. That's not what it says. It says a counselor. It doesn't say that it was just elected. I can read this all and say this right here.
No, it was a gray area that we asked for assistance from the city attorney.
But it's not a gray area in the charter.
Well, why did... The attorney say that to us?
Well, you know, the attorney in his letter talked an awful lot about Section 201 and back and forth and back and forth. But he stated the provisions of Section 206 regarding forfeiture of office of a sitting councilor for non-payment of taxes are clear. And I agree, they're perfectly clear. So read them. They're so clear, and then go through the procedure.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you very much.
Gentlemen, as I told you, this isn't a threat. I am going to take this to court.
Lock yourself out.
And
I'll take it.
You have to deal with whatever.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Gary.
Comes out of it.
Thank you.
Any other questions? I'm sorry, sir, was it James?
My name?
Yeah.
Michael Stiggle. Sorry about that.
I'm sorry, sir.
Yeah, Michael Stigl, representing Aunt Maggie's farm.
Anybody have any questions for Michael? Anybody have any questions? Oh, I'm sorry.
Can I come up to the microphone? I asked this question last time you were here, but I never did get the answer.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
That wasn't your fault. What is the difference between medical caregiver marijuana and medical marijuana? What's that caregiver
status?
Yeah.
Okay. Medical caregiver status is something that you apply for through the state of Maine. They background check you, and then if they deem you fit, when you fill out the application, you set a certain amount of plants, if you're going to grow plants, in full mature plants that you turn into ounces of pot that you're going to sell, and they give you a specific number. And then with the caregivers, you're only allowed to have that physical amount of plants fully harvested, in your possession at any given time. What we did is we went with the lowest number because we wanted to just see how well it goes, and then we might go up a little bit, but it's very regulated. It's very regulated in the sense that if I was to open tomorrow Aunt Maggie's farm, I would have to go to a wholesaler, purchase it, then I would have to have a log trip ticket for what I physically have on me, and that log trip ticket says that I bought this amount of medical marijuana and that I'm driving it to Aunt Maggie's farm. Once I get to Aunt Maggie's farm, I've got to also log it in and say this is how much I have, and any time you sell or take away from that, you've got to document it. Anytime you add to it, you've got to document it. And you can only sell to people with medical marijuana cards. And one thing that we would do, it's not a provision of the state of Maine, but we would not sell to anyone under 21. Just as a general guideline, just because I wouldn't want to do that.
So a person can't come in off the street and buy it unless they have an actual medical marijuana
card? Exactly. If they don't have a medical marijuana card, they can't buy it, they can't access it, they can't see it. One of the biggest things that we worked diligently on when we considered the city of Caribou for a medical marijuana bakery and dispensary was to say, hey, we were told that through the grapevine that Caribou wanted it to be like a doctor's office. In other words, you walk in, there's a reception area, there's no weed or any sign of weed, you can't see anything. There's a reception area, they would check your ID, they would check your medical marijuana card to make sure that it's active. Then you would, through a secure door, you'd get buzzed in, and then you could go back and you could pick what you need for medicine. And we would have security, obviously, security cameras, and anyone that works in the facility or that is in the facility would have to be background checked from the state of Maine and have a caregiver's license as well. It's very strict. I would think that it's very strict. And I do know of a place here in town that's been operating, I don't know how many years, 4 or 5 years, it doesn't even matter, over the river somewhere up on a hill. That person's operating a caregiver retail store out of their home. I can tell you that Aunt Maggie's farm would not be operated anything like that. It would be very professional, very sanitized in the way that we do operations. There wouldn't be anyone in the building that is not employed at any time by Aunt Maggie's farm. And furthermore, I can just say that we would follow all the rules that are put out through the state, and we would work with the police chief and the city of Caribou to make sure that people are happy. We're not trying to bring something to hurt the community. And we realize that there is a real drug epidemic out there. I can tell you, medical marijuana for me has gotten me off of a lot of pills, because after I had that brain injury, I had to take suffer pain and attention and, you know, and I used it very infrequently, but I used it to help me get off of all of the pharmaceuticals. And there's a lot of cancer people that, you know, Aunt Maggie is an aunt of mine that had cancer, you know, four times. And, you know, she used it to help with the pain of stomach cancer. I think that we want to target people that actually really have a medical need, not recreational people.
Was the issue last meeting the fact that you couldn't do this inside the city limits? Is that what?
Well, the issue honestly was, and why I was so passionate and my mouth got me in trouble, but I was so upset, is because we did everything that we were asked to do by the city of Caribou. Like, we paid money, we put it in the paper, we followed everything to the letter. And then right when the planning board passed it, right after that, I was told that there was someone in the community that works for the town that wasn't happy and that we needed to figure this out. And then they were like, we're not giving you the use permit, we need to bring it to city council. And next thing you know, the landlord that we given made a contractual agreement with, gave money to, said that there was an issue. And I've been in politics, and I've been around, 49 years old, I'm not stupid, I know what happened. And all we're asking is to have those things fixed. I just want to move forward in a positive way. And if there's something that the town is worried about, work with us. We're not Richardson's Remedies. We're not going to do anything like that. We want something that is sustainable for people that have a medical need for marijuana. That's all I can say. And it would be very, I mean, if you hadn't been to Timberwolves in Mars Hill, take a look in there. We get upscale people. We get people from around the world. And I had to fight for it, and I had to work hard, but we have a beautiful environment in there, and people pay for it. And we want to bring something good here too, not something to take away from moving the city forward. I mean, I know that unemployment is probably high here, and there is a drug epidemic here, and we definitely would not want to participate in making that worse. We want to kind of discreetly be there for the people that need us.
Thank you, sir. Any questions for Christina or comments? Hearing none. All right. Thank you very much, everyone. Item number 5, City Council Minutes, September 8th, regular council meeting. Chair will entertain a motion to accept the minutes.
So moved.
Moved by Doug, seconded by Joan, to accept the September 8th regular city council minutes. Any comments, questions?
You can if you want.
Hearing none, all those in favor? Motion carried. Thank you very much. Item number 6, reports of officers, boards, and standing committees. This is a part of the time of year when we're going to start to look at the different budgets that we have throughout the different departments within the city. And I think the goal is to have something done by, we have to vote on it by December 15th, is it?
By charter, the council has to pass the expense budget for next year by December 15th.
By December 15th. Like last year, it'd be nice if we could do it on the first meeting in December. And we can all have a nice Christmas. So that is our goal, and it's just a goal. Dennis. Take her away.
Tonight, you can see on the agenda, we have 5 different departments we'd like to present to you tonight. Some of them are fairly small. And if there's anyone in the audience that would like a copy of this information, I have it here on the table. I passed out a hard copy to the council, so you have that in front of you as well as electronically. You want that? The first the department that we want to look at tonight is health and sanitation. This department is primarily made up of expenses from the Aroostook Waste Solutions. We have it titled Tri-Community Landfill in the document, but they have since changed their name to Aroostook Waste Solutions. And the dollar amount that is in the budget is just over $258,000 for 2021. This number, it comes as a rolling three-year average from the landfill itself, and it's based on the amount of material that is taken there from our community. And we pay that three-year average helps to smooth out the expenses to the city. In talking with Mark Draper, who is the manager over there, and they have not prepared a final number for us for 2021, but he suggested that for budgeting, preliminary budgeting purposes, that we assume a 3% increase for 2021, so that is the number that is in your packet tonight. The COPE officer that we have, currently Chief Scott Susie, acts as our health officer, and so when there's issues with sanitation and conditions in residences and businesses, he comes in and has to make certain decisions based on health codes. And so there's a small stipend in there for him to do that extra work. Any questions on health and sanitation? Department is the fire EMS. You'll see the note that on the agenda we have the operating budget presentation separate from the capital budget presentation. By charter, the department heads are to report to me by October 1st with their operation budgets, and then by October 15th to present their capital budgets for next year. Much of what is in your packet tonight, we'll go through from the capital side after Chief Susie walks us through the operational aspects.
Sorry, I gotta put my eyes on. Mayor and councilors, the 2021 budget tried to stay flat best I could all the way down through the line. Starting off at the beginning, there was there will be an increase to salaries that has to do with 53 weeks in 2021, not 52 weeks in 2021. That goes down through there. Next change would be in new equipment, looking to do something with 2.5-inch hose line. Instead of using it in capital, did a slight increase in operations and new equipment so we wouldn't have a capital expenditure, and we can over time start replacing out old pieces of that instead of having to put money away for it. Coming down to the next increase, Dennis has in there the health insurance and zero down to the next increases would be in water and sewer. That's for additional house use right now through standing policies we have for infectious disease and the COVID responses basically. So those increases are for the water and sewer. Building supplies, same thing, there's an increase there, but that's mandated cleanings. There's been a lot of cleaning products purchased through the pandemic. If things start to suppress, then of course that number will decrease. Coming down to the next one that I have, insurances, retirement. I don't have any of the numbers on that. The next one that an increase on those turnout gear. That's an anticipated piece that I have for that we lost just due to retirement. A local vendor that used to do all of our repairs, and I've yet to negotiate anyone to be able to do that for us on industrial machines. So any repairs that need them to have to turn up here now have to be sent out. I hope to be able to take care of that locally with somebody that has industrial machines. And we can take care of the product side of it and build in the repairs. So that's an anticipated. Next thing coming down through gas, oil, and filters, there's an increase in bulk oil. And then I have an increase in batteries. The monitors, the batteries are 5, some of them are 6 years old. They needed replacement. We had to replace one out of operations this year. We don't have any backups anymore. So I had to get one back up in the house. And this is to replace 2 more of those old batteries. The next one you'll see is bad debt allowance. Council challenged us last year to take a look at our departments, our operations, how things were being handled. The council has not allowed an increase of bad debt for the time that I've been fire chief. We've always stayed at the $100,000 mark. And bad debt is like anything else. It goes up every year. The percentage of what you don't get increases every year. With that being said, we just keep it at $100,000 year to year to year, and it's not money we're spending, it's just money that people aren't paying us. It's the co-pays that they don't pay us. Blue Cross and Blue Shield doesn't send us any checks, they go to the person. We hope that they come in and pay us. And then people that decease, parts of their bills don't get paid, and we have no recourse, so those just kind of pile up and build up. So again, it's not money we're spending, it's an expense, it's a revenue that we're not receiving. It is one way of looking at it. But in order to catch up on things from the past years, the recommendation is to increase it to the $140,000 mark. Again, totally on council, it's not an expenditure, it's revenue not received. Going down through, the next thing that I have a slight increase in is our medical supplies. Again, it's unfunded mandates that we're doing right now to respond for the COVID responses. If things change in that money won't be expended. That's the operational budget that I put together for 2021.
So just another talk point, I guess, on the $140,000 on the bad debt. Essentially what's been happening is the building staff, knowing that the budget was only $100,000, have held over bad debt for future years to try to stay under that budget cap. And so essentially bad debt has been, in a sense, piling up, not being recorded on the books the way it should have been. And so with that, we have this backlog now of bad debt that we're going to catch up on. I'm talking with the billing staff, it's close to $95,000 that we need to try to make up over. And so this $40,000 increase is not going to take care of all of that, but hopefully over the next few years we'll be able to realize that appropriately in the books.
How many years has the bad debt been accruing? How many years?
It accrues every year.
From when you had the $100,000 cap. Okay. How many years have they been pushing forward?
So we're up to 2018.
So since, how long have they been doing it, is what I'm asking?
Since the ambulance has been in Caribou.
What year, guys?
I couldn't tell you. 84,
the ambulance came. So there's always been bad debt. There was always bad debt contractual allowance on the expense budget.
I get that, but Dennis, you just told me that we now have $94,000 extra beyond $100,000.
Jesus, you'd be good chief, yeah. We were always capped at, or the department was always capped at that, so they did what they could do throughout the year.
Yeah, but hiding the factual numbers is not the answer. We needed that, and I'm speaking for past counselors, to make judgment, sound fiscal judgment on that department. Those should have been brought forward. How can you make a sound decision if you're not getting the true picture? You get where I'm coming from. It's just unacceptable. I can't imagine it. I just can't imagine that the full picture is not reported. For no reason. It's not the department head or the billing specialist's job to withhold information from the city manager or the city council. If there's a mandate, I understand what the goal was, is to try to stay under that 100. But that's kicking the can. The bubble's going to bust eventually. And to me, that's unacceptable.
And that's why we're bringing this to you tonight, as we identify this. We want to make sure it's reflected. But rather than bite it all off in 1 year, we're looking at how can we bite a little bit off over the next few years too.
Well, my question is it happening in other places?
Boy.
You know, I mean, I commend you guys for bringing it to us because it needed to be brought to us. And but where else is it happening in the city? That's part of the reason why I've been on council is to pay that up. And you gotta do it, Dennis. You gotta do it. Everybody's gotta do it.
I guess I, and it's for Carl to answer this question, I guess. How can you have an expense and not report it? When you say you just roll it ahead, where does it go?
Because it's not an expense. It's the same as a contractual allowance. It's an unreceived revenue.
It's a loss. It's a loss that has not been reported forward. So whose decision was it that they took upon themselves to make that decision, not to report that forward? That would be my question.
Was it Carl's decision? Was it?
It's just how it's always run. That was the cap given for bad debt. That's what was followed.
Again, this is why we're making corrections and making sure things are taken care of.
But we also have to hold people accountable.
Okay, thank you. Dennis, could you tell us the more exact number in future meetings? What this total was? I mean, you said around 90,000.
95,000.
Around 95,000. We have $95,000 we have to pay back.
No.
That's not how I'm reading
it. No, it's an uncollectible receivable. It's just like contractual allowance. It's not an expense. We're not writing a check for it.
But we counted the income. So if you count the income on one side of the ledger, you've got to do something with the expense on the other side of the ledger. Now, this is just accounting 101 from Simple Farmer Mark. The gazumpa's got to come out to zero at the end of the year.
Essentially, we have to write this money off. Like you would abate taxes on somebody's property, you have to abate the bad debt. We do submit it to collections. We have collection companies trying to go after as much as they can.
So in the general ledger, there must be this account that shows us minus $95,000.
When it gets reported to the finance office to be reflected, yes, you'll see that. But that's what I'm saying. It's been held over in anticipation that it could be made up in future years under the $100,000 mark, which we're to the point now that we can't do that.
Okay, thank you.
On the capital capital side in the packet, you'll see a spreadsheet that shows the 2021 is highlighted. Let me explain some of the font colors and different text that you see there. What I'm showing is the capital plan from 2019 to 2023. In 2019, you'll see that some of the cells have a blank spot in them. That's to represent that these were projects that were brought up in 2019 but were not funded. And in 2020, you'll see some of that same continuation of blank fields, but also some of those cells have white text. The white text means that the original budget that was passed by the council for 2021, as we went through the mill rate process, and we had to cut $170,000 out of capital, these were three lines in 2020 that were affected with the anticipation that some of those monies would stay in reserve or be used towards those projects in 2021. So for instance, the roof repair in 2020, we had budgeted $75,000 in 2020. We had a bid estimate that came in that was lower than that, so that was reduced. But the roof repair and the structural repair is anticipated probably later this year and even into 2021, so we're going to have a split budget year on that project. And so we'll have some funds that are expended from 2020 and some from 2021 to make that project whole. In 2021, you'll also see there are several lines with bracketed negative numbers. What that means is that we have existing reserve funds that we anticipate using to offset those costs. So, for instance, the remounting of ambulance 24, we have $50,000 already in reserve to put toward that project, and so we're showing it as being applied there in 2021. We have the remount, we have the structural reinforcement project anticipated. There's a line that's been discussed in the past of putting money aside, roughly $100,000 a year, towards a future ladder truck replacement. It is a piece of equipment that we already have. We know we don't need it right away. And I think in the past, the assumption was that we would defer putting any reserve money toward that replacement in the future, perhaps looking at the future lease option or lease debt option with a new piece of equipment when that time comes, rather than putting money aside in reserve for it. But we've included it again here because it's been brought up in the past for a capital discussion. There's some computers that need to be replaced, and also looking at the remounting of a future engine in 2022 as well. And then lastly, there are two lines there in the capital. We know that we have some TIP funds that can be utilized for replacements and upgrades to the fire station. And so we plan or anticipate that we would apply some of those TIP funds toward the structural project. As one of our revenues, not revenue, but one of our reserve resources for that. It was also, it's a little over $9,000. We'll put actual numbers in there when it's time for the final budget, but we have some money that the city accumulated with the 60 Access Highway building that was anticipated to be applied to our roof repairs on that building. Obviously, since selling that this year, we don't need to spend those funds on 60 Access Highway, but we can apply those again to the structural repair project as the funds that are available for that. You'll also notice in 22 and 23, there are some lines which have a brownish text with a white background. You may recall that this year we asked Criterion Brown to do an asset facility maintenance study on each of our buildings. And so those lines, which they've identified, are going to be looked at in future years, are shown here in the capital plan in that white background with brown text. And so those are things, replacing some space heaters, replacing intercom system, air compressors, replacing low voltage systems, looking at the lower parking lot repair. I know we've already talked about that. As far as the parking lot maintenance needs, and of course some other things happening in 22 and 23, but that's the distinction and why there's a distinction there of the text or the font styles there. And you'll see that with other departments as well, where Criterion Brown identified some maintenance issues or concerns. You'll see those coming into these capital proposals. And I would also add that this spreadsheet, it goes beyond 2023 all the way to 2030 with things that have been identified, and we'll definitely include that as a future capital plan looking at it. But tonight, we just wanted to highlight what's being considered for 2021.
I guess that would be a interest from my point of view, is if you went out to 10 years, figure out what we got to do, total it up, divide by 10 to try to smooth it out. Instead of going from 240,000 to 372 back down to 280, that's just in these years that I see in front of me, to try to smooth it out a little. But it also begs that we should have a meeting sometime to talk about this assessment that we've had on these buildings. Not only the fire station. I mean, you sent us paperwork, but we haven't discussed it in open forum.
Right. No, I agree. It would be good to go through those documents, go to the department heads, and look at each of those.
Okay. Any other questions for the chief?
For both, and I did get your information that what you could get for me from the fire, the ambulance transfers. Thank you. Two things. Did you make a comment, Dennis, that transfers were making money? Have you made that statement at the meeting prior, to your knowledge?
Yes.
You did. So it's making money? The transfers?
Well, we make a transfer on the expenses associated with the transfer itself are made up of the revenues we get from the reimbursement side.
Can I get your information that you base that on?
Okay.
That's where I was heading with this scenario.
Any other questions or comments?
Dennis, you and I had this conversation once when I was in your office. How much is it for a brand new ambulance?
Box up, barrel.
About
2.25.
Now, when you and I had a conversation, it was 110.
That's a remount.
That's
a van. I know we looked at
vans. No, it wasn't. We were talking about big trucks. Because I kind of, my eyes popped up and I said, big truck? And he said, big truck.
A remount is one about between 110
yeah,
and 20.
Okay, because right here we've got remount. Number 24 is a remount.
They're all
reorder payments. Yeah, I know they are cheap. We got 30,000, 60,000, so that's 90. And I don't see anything else here about, we got a half ambulance remount in 2020 for 75, but I don't see where it adds up to 110.
Oh, thanks.
I can see on ambulance number 24, we got now 9.
Thank you.
That's 110.
I was trying to find something to tell.
I
don't know if I would ever think that.
I'm specifically looking at number 24. You have 30,000, you got 60,000, so that's 90,000. So is it 90,000 to remount or 110,000?
We'll have the 75,000 of 2019 that's still in reserve, and 30,000 from 2020. This will be one of the adjustments that we can make for the expense.
So for that reserve, so you're taking off 30,000 of that reserve from 75. So you're at 45. So we've got to add another 15 to it.
Yeah.
Your numbers aren't adding up, boys. How much money are you going to spend to remount number 24? 90 or 110? And it's got to be annotated. I've got to be able to see it. If I can do my job correctly.
We'll get you the quote.
Thank you. Now, this is could be all hearsay, it probably is, who knows. I've heard that around town, I've talked to a few people, that there's certain firefighters, paramedics that are making over $100,000 a year in Caribou, Maine, working for the fire department. It's hearsay. Until I see numbers, I'm not going to say a gosh darn word. But I'd like to know how much we're paying everybody. I mean, we have it here in the expense budget for 2019. We paid regular pay was $822,283, and then overtime was $357,310. I think we start with 2019. You know, I just can't. Dennis, who knows? I don't know. Until I have hard numbers that this is what we paid. But to me, if it is true, I mean, it just seems for a population of 7,500 people, over 100 grand. I mean, you look at, I just Googled the average salary of a New York City firefighter. ZipRecruiter's got it at $48,723.
25-year veteran gets, for us, if you have 25 years, you get $18 an hour.
Okay. Again, these are just numbers right now. I'm just throwing out. Mm-hmm. And you probably would be a good idea to do that scale, the same thing you did with police. You know?
Right.
And how many years, everything else. But. Go ahead.
I've heard that same one before. And when I looked into it, it was including their benefits. And it wasn't just their salaries. Because I heard a couple that were making over 100,000, but that was all inclusive of their benefits as well. That was not just salaries.
If you want to give me some numbers, that'd be great.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you very much.
In the airport, you'll see that on the bottom line of the airport, the 2021 expenses are flat, essentially. $5 more than the 2020 budget. This does include, we anticipate that we'll have to make two fuel purchases in 2021 due to our month-to-month stirring requirement that we have on the tanks up there, and so there's more coming to the avgas line. We benefited quite a bit this year from the downturn in the economy in the spring, and that the fuel prices for avgas tanked. And we were able to make some purchases with avgas at significantly lower than what we were anticipating. So there are some funds we expect to be left over from 2020, and that's indicated in your spreadsheet there. We don't anticipate buying more fuel this year. looks like we're gonna have enough fuel to get us through the rest of this year. We'll have to make a purchase for early in 2021 and again later in 2021. We do coordinate the fuel purchases with surrounding airports so that we can also gain some efficiencies in fuel delivery across everything. So that's the biggest change, I think, in the airport. The telephone and communications line, sorry, to back to page 13, you'll see there's an increase there. And we went through our process earlier this year to modify our phone systems, our internet systems. On the whole, we make out better than we were in 2019, but there are some facilities that have increased costs for telephone and internet, and this is one of those departments that you'll see an increase to those two lines, but on the whole, the city is coming out better because of the switch that we made earlier this year. Heating fuel, you'll see that's gone up a little bit as well. We have had more traffic in the main hangar, and so in order to keep that one without freezing what's underneath the slab there, we anticipate some increased fuel cost. And the $7,000 is still lower than we had in year-end 2019, but $500 more than budgeted in 2020. I don't know if there's any other questions you have on any of the lines for the airport.
Earlier this year, I asked if it's a policy or if we could do it. Can we pre-buy our fuel heating oil? Can we pre-buy it?
We have looked at that. Yep. And so we can pre-buy it just like anybody.
We can do it.
Yep. Yep. We have I know Carl ran some numbers earlier this year, and we actually encouraged the department heads to pre-buy some of their fuel because of the low cost of fuel that we were seeing at the time.
Do you think that would include the AV gas, or is that a possibility?
They require us every 9 months to buy new. We can check with them and see if there's any kind of a futures price that we can get. One of the issues we have is when you enter into a contract of that kind, you're guaranteeing that you're going to purchase certain amounts of fuel. And with the airport, we don't have any static number that we can say for sure we're going to be buying that or need to buy it. But we can look at it.
Even if it's a minimum amount.
Right.
If the price is exceptionally, it's an exceptionally good deal.
We had fuel prices in Avgas earlier this year that were down around $3.20 a gallon. They've now creeped back up to closer to $4. And last year, before the downturn, we were at $4.50 almost a gallon. So we bought when it was down in the dumps.
Okay. Any other questions on the airport? Doug?
In 2020, $47,793. The rents and the money that's received, does it cover that? In other words, is the airport rentals, is it self-sustaining?
No.
Not by a long shot, or what's the fair statement?
Let me pull up our report from last year. So, airport revenue in 2019 was $55,719. And the expense year-end was $59,025. 59,025. So
is it too much to ask. I mean, I think it's at best it's a hobbyist airport for hobbyists, that we look at ways to make that operation cover at least its cost, at least to a break even point for the taxpayers.
The fees or the lease rates that we've adopted, the council adopted in 2018, and certainly we can bring those back to the council and revisit those. And provide notice to the tenants that those will be going up with notice requirements.
Just to clarify, this exercise that we're going to be going through now, from now until, well, December 15th, when we have to vote on it, only for expense purposes.
By the charter, we're only supposed to leave, well, not really supposed to look at it, but certainly we'll be bringing revenues to you to kind of compare as we go through the process and get closer to December.
Okay. Paul?
I'm just trying to figure out what we're spending so much electricity. What are they using up there for electricity? I mean, they're turning lights on, they're taking their plane out, they're going back in. They're not. We don't have a mechanic up there. I mean, is this have that separated out between hangars and the main hangar, correct? It's all one meter?
No, we have separate meters up there.
I try to pinpoint where that's coming from. Are we using it from the main hangar, or is it the auxiliary hangar that we just built?
I believe the airport hangar, as noted in the spreadsheet, is the new six bay.
That's the new six bay.
I'll confirm that.
What are they using electricity on?
Plug in a space heater for the airplane or something.
Yeah, that's fine. That'd be great if that came out, space heater up there. Would our insurance even cover that? Because it's supposed to be a non-heat hangar. I mean, so if they put a space heater up there, well, now you're turning it into a semi-quasi heated pen. I mean, granted, I don't think a little space heater is going to be able to heat that, but, you know, we had the same issue with migrant housing. You can't have hot plates in the barracks. Just the way the insurance was. That's why we built them a brand new kitchen. It's got to be kind of the same thing. Now, I know we don't really have a project up there, but do we keep an engineer on a contract so they can come work up the airport? Is that something that we do?
We have an engineering firm that's contracted to help us with the red tape of the FAA and the DOT.
When does that go up to bid? How often does it go up to bid again?
I believe it's up for later this year, actually.
Later this year. So, is that something that we've been advertising? Hey, come this such and such a date, we're going out to rebid.
We haven't advertised it in the outside, no.
Where is that in the expense? And how much do we pay per year?
Under line 153 on page 1. Page 14, okay. Air consultant contract.
Yes. So are we going to spend, like 2019 we spent, about 10 and a half, spent 9,100, and this year it went down. So next year it's going to go up.
In 2019, we had the completion of the six-bay teen hangar project, mm-hmm. And so the contract with the consultant was the additional time spent on that project we would compensate them for. Mm-hmm. And it was part of our match toward the hangar project. In the years prior to that, that line on the left is a three-year average of what we were spending on them. And so in 2018, there was a lot of design cost associated with it. In 2020, they didn't do any design work for us, and that's why is very minimal. Well, it's still $1,500.
Still a contracted price. We have to even whether they work or not.
I know there is a more local firm that has expressed an interest in providing some of those services.
Yeah. I mean, where's this firm that we have now? Where are they based out of?
Out of the Bangor or Odessa?
It's off yonder, basically. So south of us.
Right.
So. Okay. And the other thing I wanted to touch on is the internet. And it's the same thing with the fire department. We have Pioneer right now. Is that who we have our internet through?
Most of them are through Pioneer.
Through Pioneer. It's like with the fire department, we've got internet at, is that a little over $1,000 or something? I know it's in the grand scheme of things. But what's your download speed there, Chief? 20?
Yeah.
20? Here are the guys spending the night there. Probably can't even watch a movie on Netflix. The buffering. You know,
fire.
As counselors, it's my view and opinion, as counselors, or just one of seven. We've got to look at numbers, and we've got to try to beat it down and everything. We might not all agree. We might not all talk. We might not even say hi to each other. Gosh darn it. Somebody's going to be living over there and doing the job that these guys do. We ought to look at getting better internet. Out of the farm, I pay $860-some-odd a year, and I got 200 megabytes per second down, 10 up. I mean, granted, it's only one phone line included. You guys got more phone lines there, but we need to do something. Even now, at the beginning, I did just a quick speed test on the internet here. It's like 1.2. How do you guys get that working?
It's stronger in other places in the world.
Shoot, well, I had a higher megabytes per second with all the routers that are looking around this place, I'm sure. We need to get better here. And it's not only here, it's the rep. Public works everywhere. We ought to really take a second look at what Spectrum can do for us. And at least to the people downstairs and over in the other building.
Now,
that's 107, but we've got to do something better for that. And that needs to be looked at in the 2021 expense budget.
Dennis, you said we had separate meters. We have a new tenant that's different in years' time up there. Is that a separate meter deal? How did that work out? Do they use electricity?
If somebody goes into the main hangar, they just have a flat rate that they pay. And we presumably it's covering our costs. But again, we'll bring those back to you to look at those more closely. The tenants that are in the 6-bay TA are in a similar fashion, it's a flat rate that presumably is covering the cost of having electricity to their building.
Okay. Anything else on the airport for Dennis? Okay, Dennis, thank you.
The Caribou Trailer Park, now this is one that we love to talk about every year. And what you see here is a significant increase in the budget from 2020. We were looking around $13,000. 2020, and we're now closer to $20,000 in 2021. Part of that is the abandoned trailers that we're starting to see in the park, and in the process to go through to remove those trailers, we've already $8,000 for the removal of two trailers. We, of course, have our contract agreements with the tenants. If someone chooses just to walk away and don't want to deal with it, we are the landlords of the trailer park. There's processes that we have to go through as landlords in this situation, not just as a city. And certainly somebody can, and one in particular has, walked away, anticipating that the city will just take ownership of the trailer and demolish it when we see fit. And so we have, as I said, $8,000 in there for the potential removal of two trailers this year. One of them, the roof has already collapsed in on itself and not having a roof. We believe another one to be abandoned. It's not in any real, from what we can tell, severe disrepair. The property around it's not being maintained. We tried to reach out to the tenant that we have. Right now we're waiting for a response back. If we don't hear anything back from them, we assume it's been abandoned and have to take appropriate action that way. So we anticipate in 2021 that we'll be, instead of 13 tenants, we'll be down to 11. And again, raise the question of, do we want to just send everybody notice in 12 months this park is closed and move your trailers out? And if they don't move out, of course, and then we have the issue of they're abandoned in place and then we have to dispose of them too, but then we can only say the trailer park is closed. And so that's one of the options that we have with the park, is to provide that 12-month notice. Again, it's, if it was just the city talking to the property owner, that's a different process. But trailer park special coverage under the state code and processes that we have to follow.
If I remember correctly, we talked about this last year, and there was supposed to be a procedure beginning last year to start closure, and nothing ever happened. I drove up through there today, and if that's not an argument for the right toolkit, I don't know what is, as far as that goes. But if these rent, if this expense is up 56% this year, I doubt that you're going to raise the rents 56%. To take care of that, and those rents are not taking care of the maintenance up there, and it looks like they need some big time maintenance up there too. So I think this was supposed to be done like 30 years ago, if I remember correctly. There was a plan in place to close this down, but we really, this doesn't look good for the city here. It really doesn't, and I think that we should finally start the procedure to do this, to close this.
I thought we did.
We were supposed to. We talked about it last year. Last year, they were supposed to start a year, because it's going to take a year, and nothing ever happened. But
I know we talked about it. I don't remember a formal motion, yes, start the proceedings, but I know we've talked about it.
I mean, I thought that you were going to get the ball rolling at that point, and it didn't, but, you know, it's costing the city. I mean, don't even just look at the less rents that you're getting now because of the abandonment, but what it costs to take care of those abandoned trailers. And I think that property's got some value there, as far as adjacent to the airport or for doing something else with it, but that's not those homes or really not really good.
Since Hugh's here, the infrastructure of the pipes that are in the
not good.
How many quote unquote leaks do you think there are?
We get a lot of food flow from that whole area. And we just finished a kind of a mini project working with the city to close off the upper portion that is completely abandoned. But this lower portion, options, we have a lot of customers that are still connected.
motion that we start the proceedings and have a formal vote on it. I'm happy to.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Well, what's the motion? What exactly is the motion?
Close the trailer park as soon as possible.
Let's set a date.
Moved and seconded. By you. Right?
Yep.
Seconded by John. Let's start the procedure of closing the trailer park. Is that how you want to word it?
Okay.
Any comments or questions?
I'm going to start immediately on that. We don't want it to go if it was discussed a year ago and you know what I'm saying, put her in play.
Okay. Under the word discussion, it was discussed last January. So discussed it seriously. Do you know what happened? This thing called the virus showed up. And everybody went into a tailspin. You couldn't even figure out how to even meet to talk about it.
I met a council. I met in my chair. It was kind of more comfortable at my house.
So that happened. I don't know, something funny happened along the way about what we're charging surrounding communities for ambulance service. That popped up out of nowhere. And I know I was hoping that this would have been something that the land bank could have grabbed a hold of and developed it on behalf of the city. But the virus and everything else showed up. And you can only burn the candle at both ends for so long. And we just took and it went to the wayside. I agree, you're going to get it started again. Let's hope we don't have another outbreak of virus.
Mayor, I actually think that it was not this January we talked about it. I think it was last January that we talked about it. Because it was going to take a year to do the process. So it wasn't this January.
I remember we also had discussions this past year.
And we probably have, but it just seems like that's
it comes up, I'm sure, every year.
Yeah.
For the last 20 years. Okay, there's a motion on the table. All those in favor? Those opposed? 5-1. Councilor Bowman. Okay. Yeah.
You can have that in concert with working alongside with the Blight Committee.
Well, we haven't even got the Blight Committee. I mean, we're right there on the cusp.
We also have the FAA that has control of the ground under the trailer park. So that's an additional level of mess.
So what would be the procedure to try to get this Blight Committee to be involved?
The first procedure is for the city to do their job and send them the 12-month notice.
But I agree.
It would be the Blight Committee. Yeah. The Blight Committee wouldn't send that notice.
No, but they should.
At this point, it would be the city. And let's just see what the fallout comes from this one. Let's send that letter up.
So, jumping back to the budget, Mayor.
Go ahead.
So in 2019, the trailer park had a revenue of $18,000 and an expense of $14,733. So to say it's a moneymaker, terrible. But we have seen quite a few pipe repair requests coming in. There have been valve issues that we've had to go look at that we haven't done in the past. I know that the internal road system is minimally maintained at best. And so certainly we want to try to, before we incur some major expenses for 11 tenants, and we'll skip this down.
Yes.
I just had one other comment about the FAA that you brought up. Years, and I mean years and years ago, that's when the FAA, if I remember correctly, got involved in that trailer park because they did not like that many trailers in that area for the taking off and the landings. And they started moving out a little bit, a little bit. They closed the section of the trailer park, but back in, I think 2012 or 2013, when I first got on council, and I was on the airport committee, and we had a meeting with some people, engineers, and somebody from the Boston area. I don't know what exactly, I don't remember what it was. But during that discussion, they never said anything about the trailer park in our discussions. And so they had a map, and when I said, well, what about the trailer park? What are we going to do about that? And they looked at me and they said, what trailer park? And I said, the trailer park that's sitting up there right now by the airport. I don't know, the FAA forgot about it and didn't put it in the report. They had nothing. They did not have any knowledge that there was a trailer park up there at all. So it kind of dropped off the radar, the whole thing. So if there's nothing with the FAA right now, and talking about this, I think it's because they just forgot about it, because these people did not know about it.
The trailer park land itself is within the boundaries of the airport master plan.
Right.
And the airport master plan anticipates future hangars being built, not necessarily by the city, but maybe private hangars in those areas to help generate some revenue. And so if we want to look at some other type of development on there, we have to go through the process with the FAA to amend the master plan and get them to sign off on that. But it is doable. It's just, I'd say, another level of red tape we're going to have to work through on that property.
1 inch at a time. Notice is going to be sent out, and in 12 months, something's going to happen. There's just going to be a big field up there. Then we can address, can we develop it? Right?
Right.
Is that how I see it going forward? I mean, no right. sense worrying about developing it now. Because even if it was just a big field, it would be to our advantage for the time of consumption and dealing with
I'll have for the next agenda, we'll draft the notice letters and get those out as soon as we can. And on the next agenda, we'll have a report on procedures that we have to follow through with and rights that the tenants have and so forth.
I'd also like to see someone tell us, what options do we have for, as a city, to help those people move? If any. Even, I don't know if the council's interested in even helping them. I'm sure we are. Somehow. And relocating them.
There are some options, and if the city or as the landlord is going to provide assistance like that, we could actually close the park down sooner. A 12-month notice under state statute would mean that we're not obligated to help them move if we've given them 12 months to do that. But we can walk through that in the next agenda.
I would like to see something of an exploratory nature that we're looking at options in this letter, instead of just a down outright eviction. Is eviction the right word? Is that what we're doing here? We're evicting.
I'm not
going
to use that term because I'll have to go back and look at the state statute and see what term they use.
Well, then, for my benefit, could you tell me what term I'm supposed to use in the future if this issue comes up?
I trailer park.
Yep. Anybody else have any questions on the trailer park?
Last one that's on the agenda is the cemeteries. You're over here in the city. Has a small amount of funds that we provide to the caretakers of the cemeteries. By state statute, the city is required to maintain and take care of veterans' graves. As this little bit of money goes towards the caretakers or the managers being able to do that service on our behalf. And you'll see line 172, Memorial Day flags. That is a fund that we've allocated to help pay for flags that also get placed on those graves and that is handled by one of our local veterans organizations.
A couple months ago, I asked you who owned one of the cemeteries, and you gave me an answer. I'm just out of curiosity. What happens if nobody takes care of the cemetery in this community? Pick any cemetery, I'm not picking one, but let's just say it's abandoned.
You don't have to talk to me.
Best of my recollection, if nobody takes care of the cemeteries, the city is obligated to maintain the veteran headstones. And that would be all. So we would have to know where all of the veteran headstones would be located at, and then we could maintain that.
I'm just wondering about the issue of what happened. A fairly good sized cemetery didn't have the funds anymore to take care of it. And these are minimal funds, can I say that, to maintain the cemeteries?
Very minimal.
Very minimal funds that we give.
Benny, can you help?
I'm just curious to what happened.
The paper.
But that was a question for you.
We've got several large cemeteries in this community. Lot of manpower.
Any other questions on cemeteries? Okay. Thank you, Dennis.
So we anticipate on the next agenda.
Fire and ambulance is a pretty good one that could have looked at.
Well, we gotta cook the food a little bit. It's a dad joke. I'm a dad. It's a dad. The process is through letter to the council. And as we stated earlier, the department heads have submitted their budgets to me. We'll work through those budgets. By November 15th is when I'm supposed to present to you my recommendations, and then you'll have from November 15th to December 15th to do what you like with the budget as well. And so I would just ask that the council by our next meeting provide me some direction of where you'd like me to go in my preparations so that the November 15th budget is hopefully going with what you as a council are looking for at that point. So it might also cut down on some of the time that we spend in December working on it.
Okay. Thank you. Item 6B, City Manager's Report. Dennis.
In the council packet on page 22, at the start of my regular manager's report, several projects that we're continuing to work on. Since Christina's here tonight, I'm going to put her on the spot to talk about events and marketing and what kind of things that she's working on, and provide a little more detail into what's being planned as far as fall activities.
So we are working with Remax North Realty and the Par and Grill and having a Halloween decorating contest. First prize and second prize will be gift certificates to the Par and Grill, both for residents and businesses. And then there's another component of the contest that I'm forgetting. Oh, and then we're going to make a map of all the houses that have signed up for the contest and make a scavenger hunt for all of the citizens to participate. Also win a gift certificate. Then we are doing a drive-through trick-or-treat over at the rec center as long as everything COVID-related stays as it is right now. Kids will be able to drive through in their cars and staff will be there to hand candy into the cars. We are also working with the Boys and Girls Club. Actually, this is this week on Friday. The Boys and Girls Club of Border Towns, based in Presque Isle, but they also have a bunch of kids in Caribou, are going to have a drive-in movie at Spruce Haven on Friday night, Hocus Pocus, so everybody's invited to that. And then going into November, we'll have our Small Business Saturday as usual. And right now it's looking like gingerbread is also going to be a drive-through. So more details will come out on those, but that's preliminary what we're working on. Candidate forms this week as well. So please get your questions into me. If anybody out there has any questions, send them to me. I think that's it.
While you're there, Christine, will you also touch on the VMS building and what kind of discussions there's been about reuse of that and the tenant?
VMS, fabulous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know too much. I just know they did have a successful job candidate search at the rec. Do you remember how many were there? It was quite a few.
They ended up by having about 45 to 50 come in.
I think it was 45 on the first day, and then they had another 15 or 20 on the second day. They were very happy with their turnout and very happy with the candidates as far as they know. And yeah, they're looking into the VMS building. That's about all I know though for now. I don't have an opening on Pronto Burrito. I don't have a date on that yet. It looks very promising that it will be soon. Other updates I'm trying to think of.
We're still waiting on the Hilltop development for ribbon cutting. Okay.
Yes, still waiting on that one. Is that it? I think I gave you a couple others today. I think that's it. Well, I'm over here if we think of anything else.
I don't know, but I got a question for you. A couple months ago, you came in and you talked about that.
Yeah.
And I kind of wanted to touch on, I was thinking about this the other day as I was driving tractor picking carrots. Our logo, like you said, our logo doesn't have Caribou, Maine on it. It just says the most northern city in the United States, northeastern city in the United States. Is there any way we get a logo redesigned? I mean, you're pretty good at that stuff.
Yeah, no, I've been through a logo redesign for a city before, a previous city I worked in. It does take some community input, though, because we want the community to feel ownership of the logo.
You know what would be a great idea?
Yes. I mean,
the new school's opening up.
Yeah.
Contest for the students. I remember being in school around this place and having a little contest. But, you know, we're trying to brand care.
Yeah,
we're trying to brand Caribou and make it business friendly and everything. Most northeastern, what are you going to get on Google to figure this out? You should be right there.
That's always been my contention, too, that it doesn't actually say Caribou. And you really could interpret, is that a deer? Is that,
Is it Presque Isle? Is it Fort Fairfield? We don't know.
Right.
I don't know. It's up to you, Dennis. I mean, you're everybody's boss and kind of do that deal, but I mean, as far as the logo,
I'm open to it. We would need a community. We would need a committee.
I don't know how the rest of the council feels. I mean,
sure we have some community members who are very creative and artistic too that would jump on this and help out.
I think that and talking to Mr. Doak and saying, hey, you know, everybody's going back to green here shortly. Maybe in the new year they have a contest.
Let's try it. You're good with it?
Going down through the list, right, to page 22, just to highlight some of these. Or as far as the bird's eye cleanup, we're still waiting for CBS to finalize their report to DEP so that we can move forward on that project of cleaning that up some more. The facade improvement program, we do need to make appointments to the facade improvement grant selection committee based on what was adopted. And so if anybody out there would be interested in serving on the facade improvement selection committee, they can turn their names into us and we can present those to the council for consideration. Also, we need to have some additional discussion of, we haven't expended all of the funds from the facade improvement grant this year, but under the new guidelines that were adopted, some of the applicants who were not eligible under the old guidelines would be eligible under the current guidelines. So it would be good to have some discussion with the council as far as opening up the eligibility for this year for the applicants that would apply for funds this year under the current rules. And we can have that on the next agenda if you'd like, Mayor, for some action on those things. The big news on the power plant is that at this point the power is turned off. Percent is out of the building as far as their operations are concerned, and Algonquin Power has moved all of their office out of the steam plant as well. Apparently they had somebody from their Algonquin Safety Committee come up and floor it and said, you have to be out of here the next day. And so Algonquin is now out. Both companies still have equipment and records in the building. I walked through it last week, and there are shelves full of historic photos of the construction of the plant, operations, and some different things. And so we want to work with your Senate and Algonquin as far as making sure that they have the records that they need for their operations, and maybe work with the local historic society or even the library archives and being able to get some of the historic nature things that go over there.
Tell them, go down here tomorrow.
Toppers.
Go there. All the historical stuff. It's part of this city. It needs to be done more often. Now there's a bonner down on the ground or on the East West Scott Road. No idea who built it. No, we Penny and I kind of went through this. History is pretty important to a lot of people. Just tell Hope to go get it.
Well, we still have to provide notices and work through more than one who is still solvent at this point. So that's another leg that we're working with. Down under major administrative projects, we had the mandatory pre-bid meeting with contractors for the structural work at the fire station last week. Bids are due October 15th. That will be on the council's next agenda for award of that. We anticipate, or through the bidding process, it was anticipated that the council would take final action when that was brought to you as going through the formal bidding process. And what would be presented to you really is all of the bids, and the recommendation that will come to you will be to award the bid that night so that we can keep that project moving forward. As far as T Park, Mr. Marquis is here tonight. Gary, do you want to just give us a quick update on T Park? And particularly the new splash pad.
T Park is coming along very well. The construction company was in there this morning, taking care of some of the punch list items. We've planted a seems like a ton of trees, but we've got a lot of trees in. We put the uprights in for the new scoreboard that we're going to mount here hopefully this week. But the park is coming along very well. We did get a bid for the new splash pad construction for next year. One bid came in a little high, but it came in at $304,000 to install the whole entire unit. They are currently working with the subcontractors right now to see if they can get the price down a little bit. So I've got a meeting with them this week to see where they're at with their prices and see what we can come up with some creative finance and get this project done. The community has been without a pool since 2013, so we'd like to see if we can get this project wrapped up, hopefully in the fiscal year of 2021. But the park is coming along well. A lot of kids have been using the basketball courts. People have been playing tennis, and it's going to be a beautiful feature when it's all completely finished. So we're very excited about it. Plugging away, trying to get the little parts done. Anybody have any questions? Thank you.
Gary, can you get me the what I need to do in that panel to mount that? The header's coming from the factory.
The header's coming from the factory.
So if I know what I have to accept that.
Yep, I'll get it to you. Thank you.
On page 23, again, just highlighting some things. The City Hall boiler system. You may recall that we had our insurance company come through and inspect, as well as Criterion Brown looked at this building, and both have recommended that repairs need to be done as quickly as possible on the boilers. The indication that we received from the contractor that typically repairs those is that these are 30 years old and no parts have been made for the past 10 years for these boilers. New boilers, they did provide us a quote for new boilers and installing a new chimney liner. And the estimated cost came back at almost $43,000. We are still wanting to look at the option of if we can place the boilers in the same room as the pellet boiler or remove the pellet boiler since that's not functioning, and just use the chimney liner that's already there and try to maximize expenses that have already been incurred in the past. So we are looking at some options with that. At the airport, we did finish the crack seal project earlier this year. Right now we anticipate holding off on the apron all the way until 2021. Didn't bring that up in the budget discussion earlier, but we have been informed by the state DOT that we need to get an overlay done. We may be able to apply for some of the FAA funds or use FAA funds to help in that process. The River Road, we received the final geologic report from DuBois and King. That was the last piece of information that we were waiting from them. And it's available if anybody would like to read it. And additional discussions have taken place with Dr. Chonka that we can discuss in the real estate executive session if you'd like to discuss that some more. As far as the investment policy, Carl Grant and I met with Scott Violet from Veresi Financial. He was the gentleman that was recommended by Bruce Eggleston. We wanted to meet with him ahead of time, talk about the state statutes and get an idea as far as his understanding of the state statutes and what possibilities there were. We haven't set up a presentation yet with the full council, as was discussed, but he did provide some email comments back when I've included in the report. Specifically, it says it is theoretically possible to build a portfolio with the investment options available within the statute. The account could have some liquidity, income, and safety of principal. Might be tough to get much yield at this point using the instruments available, but it's also tough to get yield in the CD as well. there are some very limited options that we talked around the table about, but certainly we can have them come into the council and talk more about that. We did make it clear that if we do want to pursue some of these other investment options, that we would send out an RFP, and there would be a competitive process in which to utilize or pick somebody's experience and resources to help us in that process. So, Mayor, I guess I just work with you on when you want to have a question of the council, or you want to just put that on the next agenda as well?
Next agenda. Tentatively next agenda. Let's see what else pops up over the next couple of weeks.
Okay. Last year, concerned about the tax acquired property policy and the processes of getting information to the council, I wanted to inform the council that we have already started the process this year, which is outlined in the policy that establishes that the finance director or the tax collector will provide a list of all of the potential lien foreclosure properties to the city staff. That list has been distributed, and I just finished up today what the policy refers to as a checklist, and I'll be sending that out to the department heads as well. And it specifies which department heads need to be looking at which elements of these properties, from the environmental side to the valuation side and occupancy and so on. So we'll be able to bring to you as a council a recommendation, and you'll see the analysis that's done. We expect that many of these properties will probably fall off of the list. Right now we're looking at 86 properties that are potentially to be foreclosed on. The process is we send out a notice or a threat of foreclosure, and then people will come in, and usually they'll pay off what they need to get their name or their property off of that list. And what finally comes to you, we'll have a breakdown of what we see the issues might be with those properties. So the parking lot paving on the North Mall parking lot, our public works director today was confirmed with Solidberg Construction. They will begin working on that later this week when the manager report went out on Friday, which was last week, and so that's why it says next week. But just to clarify, we anticipate they'll be on the ground later this week with that. I think that's all I have as far as the typical manager's report. If there's any questions on those items, we can try to address those.
No questions. Charter consistency of council actions. Item 6B1.
You have in your packet a memo that I prepared based on looking at the charter, looking at actions that the council has taken, and in summary, I was not able to find, as I said, any blatant violation of the charter. As was mentioned earlier tonight, even by Mr. Gary Wicken, there are some things that we can certainly clean up as far as our processes. Some additional training would be beneficial for the council as well as the staff and how we look at it. But I know it was also mentioned earlier today, the intent of the charter with regards to the payment of taxes and the gray area that is there. And all I can say at this point is, yes, we did engage legal counsel on that process, and we acted in accordance with the advice that we were given from legal counsel. And there may be some additional clarifications that may be appropriate in the charter if it does not fully meet the intent. But there are processes that would need to happen in order to make those clarifications possible. But we did act in accordance with the city's legal counsel and where we are today in those processes. There are several other items that are highlighted in the memo.
Was our legal opinion shared with the folks that have a question about this?
Yes.
Okay. So they've seen Rick's memo and his recommendations. It's all been shared.
Even tonight, it was actually quoted by the people that spoke.
So I know Joan has written about it again in the paper. What are we missing?
You probably would like to have a discussion with the attorney in a work session if you want to get into the details of it. But essentially, as has been mentioned, there is a distinction between a sitting counselor and a counselor elect. And that is primarily what the basis of this decision was on, is that the charter refers to sitting counselors have responsibility to pay their taxes before December 31st. Where in this case, Councilor Morrell was a counselor elect, the opinion of the attorney was that that particular provision did not apply to the counselor elect status. But again, it would be better for the city's legal counsel to come in and explain the more that opinion and rationale that he used on the basis, if you'd like to have that.
I have a couple of things to say about that because I know what the intent was of that rule. One person who was elected was not allowed to speak, but to speak to serve. If that rule was intended for councilors or councilor-elects, it should have said that. It didn't. And as far as I'm concerned, my attorney and your attorney can have two different opinions and don't make them law until that would be in court of law said by a judge. I still think that rule should have held because the intention was clear. I know it. I sat through that, as did Councilor Morrell and several other people. And I think a lot of the replies that Mrs. Lister got were in favor of the same thing, that the intent was there December 31st, on or before December 31st of the previous year. And when you don't allow one person who was elected, she hadn't taken her seat yet, but was told that she could serve, and where we go from.
Then why'd she do it? Did she have her taxes paid before or after she was sworn in?
No, she never got a chance to prove it.
Then she should have made her case. Folks, this is getting a little ridiculous. I hear a lot of this and take it to court if you want to. Go ahead. Who cares? You know what my attorney says, what your attorney says, what your attorney says, what Gary says, Look, guys, I know back a long time ago you didn't like each other. And you guys can sit here and say that you like each other now, you have no problems, but no one cares. Let's move past this.
That's right. Nobody cares.
I don't care about your quorums back in 08, 07, back in 1954. I don't care. The young people of this community just want to see progress. That's all I want to see. And do I agree with what Doc says? Do I like his mouth? No. Ow. You know what? We're here to do a job, and I can't control what some person says. I can't control what the charter says. It was made up by a commission. And if at that time they did not have the foresight to say councilor-elect and council members have to have their taxes paid by December 31st, then that's just the way it is. Doug was not a councilor member. He was council-elect. He was not sworn in. And you guys can shake your heads all you want, but I've also had legal opinion on this. A few of the same people you people have. And it's all up to interpretation. So if you guys want to make a case, make a case. Go to a judge. But at this point, I think we've got more things to do.
That's for sure. Okay.
I think you addressed this summer when we were talking about maybe putting it up to referendum. How many other communities in the state have this in their charters?
None.
Okay. So no communities in the entire state require anything, raw taxes for any council people or select people or anything. Or one out of hundreds that do it. For some reason. Yeah. It'd be interesting to know what the reason was that this got put into this particular charter and no other community in the entire state finds it important enough to address. I think that's a valid question. The other thing, in Rick's opinion, doesn't he mention that there are constitutional implications about... Does he mention that? That there are constitutional implications, much like in the legal opinion we got for my eligibility?
Right. Okay. If someone is elected and not allowed to take office, there are constitutional issues.
Okay. So there's a other side to that blade for everybody.
So nothing earth-shattering that we, that you feel that we as a council have to back up and change in any of our votes?
No, as far as changing past votes or anything like that.
Okay.
Certainly there can be some cleaning up.
Cleaning up, I agree to that. This is a great example, councilor-elect, not, you know, sitting councilor. I agree. Okay. And I asked you to put any other questions on the notice. Did you want to say something else here?
No,
really.
I do.
I didn't mean to cut you off.
No. I'm going to change my mind.
And just to touch back on that evening, more effort was put into Gotcha Politics than would have been to pick up the telephone and say, hey, Doug, not pay your taxes, more gotcha politics. You couldn't be beat during the election. And we had the little stunt the night I took my seat. And now we have this, the legitimate next move after that is the recall. So it would have been a lot easier just to say something, you know, instead of the gotcha politics. And they blow up in your face and, you know, okay. That is what it is. Here we are.
And it's not because we don't care. It's not.
You just said you didn't care.
You don't care?
No, it's not because we don't care about the charter.
That's what you just said.
Nobody, I'm not fighting.
Okay.
Holy cow. Okay. Well, we've been doing pretty good so far with this meeting. 6B2. Well, that just was a question about morale with the city employees. Dennis, you want to just... 2 seconds.
With any large organization, we're going to have some employees in the mix. We feel excited and feel intelligent. And we're going to also have some employees that we come to work every day and we might be oblivious to some of the other concerns or issues that someone that has more tenure might be aware of. And so we sent out a survey to the police department, an anonymous survey, online survey, just asking some general questions, not only about morale, but how they felt about their job, their supervisors, the work environment. Unfortunately, we didn't get enough responses back for me to be able to say with definitive answer, this is what the department feels. But I do have, I'll just pass out some of the written comments. Some of, most of the survey was, do you agree or disagree with the statement? Again, pertaining to what I said. But there were some fill in the blanks that I'll just pass out to the council so that you can see it. These are, out of the five responses we got, what do you like most about your job, least about your job, and what is one thing that would improve morale as a department? And so, I think, as I said, you have a mixed bag on both sides. Generally, people, at least, and again, I hesitate to generalize for the whole department because it's not a very large sample set. But you'll have a mix of reactions depending on who you talk with. And I spoke with some of the officers in addition to this survey. And as I said, you have on both sides of the spectrum.
Thank you, Dennis. I would only ask that, I don't know how, and I, just my not clarifying myself correctly, would you mind sending out this questionnaire to all the city employees? Is that possible?
I anticipated that the questions that I prepared,
yeah,
they'll have to be tweaked just a little bit, but
yeah.
I anticipated doing that as well.
Yeah, I didn't mean to just focus in on one part. I know that's what I asked you to do, but I was looking at the general picture with all of our employees, union and non-union employees.
Sure.
Okay, thanks. Item number 7, we have no bid awards. Number 8, old business and adoption of ordinance and resolutions. We don't have any, do we?
No.
New business. Do we have any new business from any councilors? Hearing none. Reports and discussion by mayor and council members. Any council members have anything they'd like to say? Doug?
Yep, thank you. I guess John is gone, didn't want to wait around, but I thank him for his input. I'm going to assume from his comments that I won't be on his Christmas card list this year. It's too bad he chose to run out the door. I wanted to ask him a question and have him clarify to me about his actions and his relationship with the Sergeant of Arms in Augusta. Apparently, he wanted to just grandstand and run out the door. So, John, I'm sure you'll hear this. Give me a call, write to my email address at the city so you and I can hook up and you can explain to me those, the question I have for you. The second is the pop-up junkyard. Did it make its way to court?
Yes.
Excuse us, Chief, what you said?
Yes. Yes, it has. Because of the COVID, didn't appear, and they gave it another 30 days.
So it's been extended?
Another 30 days. Extended.
Okay.
Just to clarify, we also, we've been able to identify the current owner.
Previous owner.
The previous owner, and the additional notices have been served.
So, were they able to see anybody out there the other night loading, or were they gone?
No.
There was a silver truck removed off the property
yep.
there. Anyway, okay, my third one is the trailer park, the Westgate Trailer Park. I guess it'd probably be more to Ken and the city manager. Have you guys looked at that? Have we contacted the owner of that property to find out? I mean, there's nothing there. Nobody, doesn't seem like anybody's living there, but a lot of junk. And there's a house just up the road from them in the trees that's, I don't know, it's half burnt down or have we?
After done? After the trailer park?
Heading to the base. You pass the trailer park and then you look in there and you've got something
yeah.
blocking the drive, but when you look past, it looks like it might have been half burnt down or something.
All utilities shut up in the
What's that?
I told you, I know where you're talking.
Yeah, just curious if we've reached out to the building, the landowner on the park especially, because that right out on the main drag.
So we actually had a conversation about that piece of land where the trailer park was. Apparently it's for sale, and they've been trying to sell it on eBay or wherever they try to sell it. The trailer carcasses belong to the actual people that used to lease the lots. So that was kind of a dead end. The land itself cannot be a trailer park right now due to a lot of issues up there with the power and the sewer. So that was, and this conversation was like last fall, even into winter. We haven't done any since then.
So do we know who the owner of the property is?
Yes.
And his response was he's trying to sell it, am I correct? I don't want to put words in the mouth.
Right, so if we're thinking in terms of blight, they're trying to put value back into it, but really they're just trying to sell it and let someone else deal with it.
Okay, thank you. That's all I had, thank you.
Okay, anybody else? Paul?
The good to knows that are sent out, I like those a lot because it kind of gives us an idea of what's going on. And since I live on the Grimes Road, it amazes me that I'm even going to bring this up. Have you caught the beavers that are cutting down the trees? Because one tree is laying on a telecommunications wire.
It's since been notified of the beaver problem on the Grimes Road.
Have they done anything? I mean, it's crazy, but I mean, there's trees. Every time I drive by in the morning, it's always I've got to watch out for Evan Graves running, and I got to watch out for trees.
Yeah.
Those are two things I have to watch out for the first thing in the morning. I mean, Dennis, are we doing anything about this? I mean, are we getting pressure on the state so I don't run into a tree, or my family doesn't run into a tree, or anybody else's family doesn't run into a tree?
I know that Gary works with beaver traps in the winter time, trying to keep things clean, but
I think one of the issues is the lack of trappers. The ones that we've been using in the past, the state and the city, is no longer doing it. So there's been an issue about trapping, getting the trapper to do it.
There's a new guy around right now, and I'm actually meeting with him tomorrow. Mm-hmm. About another site, and I will run it by him.
I don't know what they're damming up out there. There's nothing to dam. I mean, hey, that's pretty ambitious if you want to dam up the Earth's
River. They want to be ready.
They want to be ready.
Yeah.
They
okay.
See how well low the water is.
It's doable now.
Did you just put that on?
Okay. Dennis, we don't have anything in executive session tonight, do we?
Only if you want to talk about the River Road.
Do you want to talk about the River Road tonight?
It won't take very long.
Okay, next meeting's October 19th and November 2nd and 16th. Chair will entertain a motion to go into executive session 405-6C. Moved by Tom, seconded by Doug. Any comments? Doug.
Just a moment.
What's your name, Dennis?
Hey.
Just for clarification of the executive session, this will be to discuss the River Road project and the property owner that was affected by the road.
All those in favor? Motion carries. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, and have a great evening.
Here we go.